My parents were born in Germany at the turn of the 20th century into families of wealth and privilege. They lived through the First World War, experiencing tremendous hardships, but through perseverance and hard work, they were able to rebuild their lives. In the summer of 1929, my father realized his dream of coming to America by bringing his new bride to settle in New York City and raise a family. They arrived just months before the stock market crash, but as head of a German bank, my father was fortunate to have the resources to live the American dream, with an apartment on Park Avenue, summers in the Hamptons, or visiting friends and relatives back in Germany. Over the years, they had three children. I was born in Hamburg, while my brothers were born in New York, making them both American citizens. In the spring of 1941, with conflict raging throughout Europe, my father was recalled to the Home Office in Berlin. Since Great Britain and Germany were already at war, we had no choice but to travel the Pacific route via Japan, through Russia on the Trans-Siberian Railroad, and on into Berlin. What my parents did not anticipate was that world events would dramatically change their plans. What was to have been a summer vacation turned out to be a 10-year unforgettable odyssey. This is their story, a story of challenges, of survival and endurance against often insurmountable odds in the midst of a world at war. Sixty-six years after having embarked on that fateful trip, my brothers and I sat down together to recall our decade-long interrupted journey and the years that followed.
I had heard about this forthcoming trip, I would say, since about March or April, and it was great anticipation because it was promised to be such something extremely exotic, something that we had never experienced or seen before. And the idea of crossing the Pacific instead of the Atlantic and passing through a land as exotic as Japan, that was very thrilling.
And very different from our usual summers of just going to visit the grandparents in the summertime. The most important thing for both my mother and father was they insisted that we all stay together as a family. And it was a very tearful, sad day, that May 29th, our father's birthday, when I left Sacred Heart and you all picked me up and we went on to Grand Central Station.
We took the New York Central Railroad to Chicago. And change trains to go on to San Francisco. Well, we would spend hours watching the countryside go by, whether it was Illinois and Nebraska down to Texas.
What I remember distinctly was the Grand Canyon when we were taken to visit an Indian chief with his war feathers.
It was like an adventure.
Which it turned out to be.
The next thing I remember was getting to San Francisco.
We sailed on June 5th, 1941 on the SS Hatsutamaru.
Our introduction to Japan really started on the ship, but on the enclosed promenade deck on the tatami, where we were having our first Japanese meal.
And chopsticks, we ate with chopsticks, which we had to learn.
I think as every healthy young four-year-old, I was just with my parents and my brother and my sister on a ship. It was just very natural as far as I was concerned. I remember the fact that there were a lot of people on board who looked quite different from the way we did, quite a few Japanese on board. Everybody was exceedingly friendly.
This ship voyage was 2 weeks, and it had a stop in Honolulu.
Remember the pretty Hawaiian girls in their hula skirts singing aloha.
The weather was warm, and I remember going to the beach as well.
beautiful beach. You said you remembered leaving Honolulu.
We were late. We almost didn't make it.
That's right.
And we were rushed up the gangplank, and then they lifted the gangplank, and we left. We were told that what we should do is throw our leis. You take them off and fling them into the ocean, and if it floats back to Honolulu, it tells you that you'll be back again.
When we got to Yokohama, we landed there on June 19th.
We were in our cabin, ready to disembark, looking out of the porthole and seeing all these very bizarre-looking people, bizarre as far as we're concerned. They had gaiters on, they had kimonos.
You could hear the clickety-clack of the gaiters. We had 40 pieces of luggage because my mother had prepared for a long, long voyage.
But then the expectation of the trip ended 3 days after we arrived, because then we discovered we could not continue as the plan had been because of the beginning of the war.
In June 1941, 135 divisions plunged deep into Russia on a 1,500-mile front that stretched from the Baltic to the Black Sea. Hitler expected a quick knockout blow within a matter of weeks.
It was my birthday, and Hitler had marched into Russia. My father and mother immediately realized that that signified the fact that we no longer could continue, because my father and mother and I were German citizens, and Anna and Alexander were American citizens, so that they would have been all right, but we would not have been all right, and we certainly didn't want to end up in Siberia.
Well, I know that he made efforts to try and get passage back.
He was waiting for a neutral ship that would take us from Japan to America.
What he did not realize is that President Roosevelt would embargo the Japanese. All travel, all shipping was banned. There was no way to get back to the United States. As a consequence, we were stuck for the moment.
My father said, well, we'll see some of Japan and then we'll go back to America. And then right after Alexander's birthday is when we went to Karizawa for 2 weeks.
Karizawa was an established summer resort. That's where people would go to escape Tokyo's heat.
We must have been considered somewhat of a curiosity because we were written up in the local newspaper.
Little did we know, a few years later, we would spend the rest of the war there. When we got back from Karizawa, that's when they decided to rent the house on the bluff, knowing that we were going to probably be for quite a while before we could go back to America. When the parents rented that house, they staffed it with a Chinese chef and two Japanese housekeepers, which we were allowed to have.
Then they enrolled us in school because by that time it was September.
Our teachers were a whole variety of nationalities. So it was truly an international school, and we just blended in very comfortably.
My father couldn't work, but the one thing he made sure is that we had a piano. He basically went back to his first love, and what he originally wanted to be is a concert pianist. And so he would play the Moonlight Sonata and Chopin by the hour. It was great therapy for not being able to work.
The is John Daly speaking from the CBS newsroom in New York. The Japanese have attacked the American naval base at Pearl Harbor, Hawaii, and our defense facilities at Manila, capital of the Philippines.
100 Japanese planes and a number of midget submarines took part in the attack. In an hour and 5 minutes, the battleship Arizona was completely destroyed and 4 others severely damaged.
I came home from St. Joseph's and found my parents sitting in the living room, saying, total white-faced, the Japanese had just attacked Pearl Harbor. At that point, they knew that we were stuck there for the duration.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy, the United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. With confidence in our armed forces, with the unbounding determination of our people, we will gain the inevitable triumph, so help us God.
The Japanese were so polite and so lovely to us. On the day of Pearl Harbor, all of that stopped. They suddenly weren't allowed to know us. They weren't allowed to fraternize. All of a sudden, the Amasans who worked for us had to report to the policeman on the bluff and the Daikanzaka where we lived.
We got into a stone throwing fight, and a friend of mine and I were throwing stones with it. These Japanese kids were throwing stones at us, and one stone caught me above my right eye, and of course I came home crying and bleeding.
Yeah, and I think we were admonished at that point because the parents said, don't ever do that again, don't pick fights. If they throw stones at you, run away, because you don't want to be arrested, you don't want to cause any problems. Another thing happened after Pearl Harbor, when Germany declared war on America. My father got a visit one day from the head of the Gestapo, Mr. Meisinger. Mr. Meisinger said to my father, why are your children not in German schools? You're a German citizen, why aren't they in German schools? And he said, well, my children have always gone to English-speaking schools, and that's where they belong. Whereupon Mr. Meisinger suggested strongly that he change and send us to German schools. Well, my father refused to do that. He was from then on considered politically unreliable because he wasn't playing ball with the Gestapo.
American people who were in Japan at Pearl Harbor, they were sent back on a repatriation ship in March of 42. The whole school went to the roof of St. Joseph's College. And we looked out over the harbor and we saw the Asamamaru steaming out. They were transported to a port called Lourenço Marques in Mozambique, neutral territories, Portuguese. And there they were exchanged for a similar number of Japanese who came to Lourenço Marques from the US and England by a boat called the Gripsholm, which is also a repatriation ship with green crosses painted on each side. That's sort of an internationally accepted symbol of a repatriation ship which is not to be torpedoed or sunk or attacked in any way.
On April 18th, 1942, came the most startling war news since December 7th. News of the bombing by U.S. planes of the capital of the Empire of Japan.
Oh, that was the raid, yes.
When Jimmy Doodle's planes came over Tokyo,
we wished them good luck, because we knew where they were going. Tokyo.
And I remember seeing a plane coming down with the black smoke trailing it.
In spite of crippling damage, the United States fleet, augmented by British, Australian, and Dutch units, set out to find the enemy. In the battles of the Coral Sea and Midway, the Japanese advance was halted. Even as the enemy made fast his grip on Hong Kong, Burma, Manila, Singapore, the Allies began the long journey back.
Do you remember in 1943 in the harbor, there were those German battleships that had come in? and there was an explosion.
We could see one or two of those ships were burning.
A lot of the sailors just jumped ship and then drowned. There are a lot of loss of lives and a lot of injured. The hospital up on the bluff was filled to the rafters.
We had German sailors who became our guests while they recuperated from their injuries.
The explosion brought about our move out of Yokohama.
We moved in July of 44.
Exactly. They thought possibly a saboteur was living on the bluff, and so they thought maybe it'd be better to remove the entire foreign community to other places. In Karizawa, there was one house left, which we moved to.
The houses that they built were flimsy. They weren't built for winter occupancy.
We then experienced one of the coldest winters ever in the Japanese Alps.
Every water pipe, the toilets, the bathtubs, everything froze. Solid.
In order to go to the John, we had to find water.
The three of us had to go up the Atagoyama. There was a well. Then we pumped these pails full of water, and then we would come down, but of course we couldn't come down without sliding. We sat down on the ice and with the pails in hand slid down, spilling of course half the water half the way. The only heat in the house was one stove. It had happened to be in my room. And that's where we cooked, that's where I slept, that's where we ate. And I remember having to set the table in this freezing winter and taking the silverware, and it sticking to my hands, it was so cold, and still had to set the table correctly.
During this harsh winter, I was the designated chicken keeper. We had two hens and a rooster. And we were able to actually get fresh eggs from these birds. One morning when I went down to feed the chickens, there, to my horror and chagrin, was the rooster stuck, frozen on the bar in the chicken coop. The poor thing had expired. And the one big event which I remember was the eruption of Mount Asama.
A lava rain which came trickling down, and the entire white countryside was
turned gray.
We would get a loaf of bread per week, and my father was always very fair, so he learned to cut this loaf into 35 slices, because this way each of us would have one prosciutto slice per day. We used to get rations. We would get a pound of butter per person per month. And my mother would usually take this pound of butter, and every day she would scrape a little bit on her bread. We would get a handful of rice per day, and we got lots of soybean paste from which we made soybean soup known as miso shiro. And we would put in whatever vegetables we could garden in our little backyard. One time, a man came by to the house secretively, and Dad said, yes, yes, fine, wonderful. And the next thing we knew, he had this half an animal in the kitchen. We had eaten horse meat, but we had had no idea that that's what it was.
Our father was able to get a large sack of potatoes on the black market somehow, and it was brought up. It was left on the porch, and then the next morning, the potatoes had all frozen. I don't know if you remember how terrible those sweet potatoes now taste, but we still ate them.
My parents always made the best of a bad situation. When my mother was depressed, my father would say, come on, you know, we gotta hang in there. And then my father would get depressed and my mother would be the one that would encourage. And they would instill on us, just keep going, keep doing, don't give up.
It was a matter of survival.
Allied sea forces moving up to the Japanese home island shelled the mainland almost without opposition, helping to hammer the enemy to his knees.
There was no food because U.S. forces had sunk all the shipping that used to supply Japan. And so we really had a severe crisis in our hands as far as food is concerned.
Iwo Jima, only 450 miles from Japan. The full power of the American Pacific fleets, of land, sea, and air forces, struck a semi-final blow. And once again, a flag of liberty was dramatically run up.
There was a Catholic church at the foot of the Atangoyama, St. Paul's. Every Sunday, we went there. So that was one of the sort of meeting places in Karizawa. Our father was born Catholic, raised in a very Catholic family. Mother came from a Protestant Lutheran family. I mean, every Sunday you went to church. Christian communities flourished in Japan. The bulk of the people who were Christian, who were not Shinto Buddhists, were Japanese. But there was no religious persecution.
But there was a little vignette about that. There was a German guy in Karuizawa called Mr. Mozana, and he was a Gestapo type, like Meisinger. And he would come to the church at the end of the Mass and observe which among the Germans were there, because they were against that. And he would make a report that so-and-so had been seen at the Roman Catholic Church.
This is a solemn but a glorious hour.
I remember distinctly when the whole German community met up in Karizawa, where it was announced that Germany had surrendered.
The forces of Germany have surrendered to the United Nations. The flags of freedom fly all over Europe.
That was the first news we had about what had happened in Europe.
Berlin's army school is the end of the road for the Nazi reign of terror. Here, Air Marshal Tedder, General Eisenhower's deputy, and Russia's Marshal Zhukov meet with Field Marshal Keitel, the haughty Prussian aristocrat and representative of the general staff. This time, the Wehrmacht takes its full share of blame for years of ruin and brutality. Berlin's history as one of the world's great capitals is ended. Not only her capital, but most of Germany's mighty industrial cities are wiped out. These first pictures of Hamburg, made by the RAF, reveal the indescribable destruction wrought by repeated air attacks on the Reich's second city.
And of course, our parents were exceedingly distressed because they had no idea what had happened to father's family or mother's family.
Hamburg is a ghost city, only the outer walls of its thousands of buildings standing in mute testimony to the overwhelming power of Allied bombing.
Yes, a total information blackout.
Well, this period between May and August of 45 was very tense because all of a sudden there was no international legal protection anymore for people who were essentially stateless.
And in May, the money ceased.
Even as they laid the foundations for a stable European peace, Clement Attlee, Harry Truman, and Joseph Stalin had decided on common action against Japan.
Well, in that period, survival was priority number one. And we had to go around and get food and firewood. There was no really time to worry about much. I just hoped that the war would end soon.
Russia joined the Allies in war on the last remaining Axis enemy.
Also, that was the time when Japanese army people used to start to patrol the paths. It created a feeling of unease.
We would get accosted sometimes, you know, by people, and they would be very, very friendly and sort of try and find out, well, you know, what were your parents doing? So the less we knew, the safer they were.
I agree with you. They didn't tell us a lot of things, but if inadvertently we heard something or they did share something, they always said, but whatever you do, keep your mouth shut.
The Japanese had not quit for lack of men or arms. Great armies waited to defend their home islands. Artillery, suicide planes, new amphibian tanks were ready for the final battle. But as the Japanese prepared for invasion, a lone B-29 dropped a single atomic bomb on the munition city of Hiroshima. Smoke rose 50,000 feet as an explosion equal to 20,000 tons of TNT brought the greatest man-made disaster in the history of the world. The Japanese were stunned, but still they hesitated. So 3 days later, another bomb fell on Nagasaki, wiping out one-third of that industrial center. That was the final blow.
The only thing the Japanese announced was that a new kind of bomb of tremendous power had been dropped. That's all they said.
Bob Trot reporting. The Japanese have accepted our terms fully. That's the word we've just received from the White House in Washington.
I have received this afternoon a message from the Japanese government in reply to the message forwarded to that government by the Secretary of State on August 11th. I deem this reply a full acceptance of the Potsdam Declaration, which specifies the unconditional surrender of Japan.
In New York City, as throughout a rejoicing nation and world.
I remember standing in the driveway, jumping up and down. The war is ended, the war is ended, and being so thrilled and so happy.
It's official, it's all over.
I remember standing behind our house and listening to the radio, to the emperor give his imperial arrest script ending the war.
He didn't say, I surrendered, because that would have been instant harakiri for most Japanese self-immolation. He said that after having seen the extent of the weapon that the enemy had, that he thought it was the better part of valor to cease fighting.
The battleship Missouri, 53,000-ton flagship of Admiral Halsey's Third Fleet, becomes the scene of an unforgettable ceremony marking the complete and formal surrender of Japan. General of the Army Douglas MacArthur, Supreme Allied Commander for the occupation of Japan, boards the Missouri. Fleet Admiral Nimitz, Pacific Fleet Commander, and Admiral Halsey welcome MacArthur and his Chief of Staff, General Sutherland, aboard. It is Sunday, September 2nd, 1945. And now, in a Navy launch, the Japanese surrender party arrives. They are headed by Agent Mamoru Shigemitsu, Foreign Minister of the Japanese Surrender Cabinet. A war which had entered its eighth terrible year in China, which had raged for 3 years and 9 months for America and Britain, which was the brutal, costly eastern half of the most horrible worldwide war in human history, is now within minutes of ending for good. General MacArthur speaks.
The issues involving divergent ideals and ideologies have been determined on the battlefields of the world, and hence are not for our discussion or debate. I now invite the representatives of the Emperor of Japan and the Japanese government and the Japanese Imperial General Headquarters to sign the instrument of surrender at the places indicated.
Mr. Shigemitsu comes to the surrender table.
After the first troops landed, we found out that the Kempeitai actually had plans to have all the Occidentals shot and killed. And I met in Stade many years later John Stewart, who had written a book. He had been in Japan, and he said, absolutely so. We were all supposed to be killed, but because of the troops landing in Japan, the Kempeitai sent through a communique saying, we don't want this bloodshed on our hands. Thanks to the Americans landing in Japan, our lives were spared.
General MacArthur signs as Supreme Allied Commander.
Japan surrendered. When did the first U.S. troops come to Karuizawa?
Within about a week or two. But this advance party, they began moving into Yokohama, lived in the park, you know, in concert huts and so on, took over the new Grand Hotel. MacArthur went there. And then these newsmen, they got into a jeep and drove up to Karuizawa because they had heard that a colony of foreigners were living way up there in the sticks.
General MacArthur expresses a wish.
Let us pray that peace be now restored to the world and that God will preserve it always.
We made plans to move back to the city because we did not want to spend another winter up there. Winter was very hard. So we wanted to go back to Yokohama. So my dad and I got on the train, went down to Ueno, and it was startling. It was total devastation.
Tokyo, three quarters wiped out by the superfortress attacks long before the atomic bomb.
It was totally destroyed. And left and right, there was nothing but rubble and twisted steel. It was unbelievable.
A city which once held 6.5 million and was to have been the capital of all Asia now lies in ashes.
I think it was in October, November that we all moved down again.
Right. Japanese in the big cities like Yokohama are faced with acute shortages of food and goods of every description. Even the standard diet, rice, is strictly rationed. Crowds gather at department stores, and Yank MPs have their hands full coping with the distracted people.
You were now surrounded by Americans.
The 209th MP station. We became sort of their adopted children.
Didn't they actually feed us there sometimes?
They fed us there, and I remember a number of occasions going into the ash cans and picking out Frankfurters and taking them home to the parents. For a while, it was pretty bad. And Anna, when did you go to work for the Navy?
That was in the summer of 46. I worked for the port director's office, right down where that pier is, where we docked. I was 15.
You were 15?
And I was an interpreter. I was also a driver, because I remember taking a cargo of nurses to Enoshima in a 3/4-ton truck, which I drove.
I think this is
at age 15.
Yes.
The troops that came right after the end of the war, who had fought their way from island to island, A, were delighted to see American kids who spoke English, A, and B, you know, having seen the horrors of war, were very, very nice. Because the guys who had fought, they said, we've seen everything, peace is lovely. Subsequently, when replacements came, they came and began lording it over people. And said, we're the occupiers.
At Atsugi Airfield, General MacArthur welcomes him to Japan. During the war, the two supreme commanders led millions of men to victory. Now they meet to discuss the problems of the peace. Eisenhower leaves for a tour of the Japanese islands with the occupation army's commander, General Eichelberger.
Lieutenant General Eichelberger, commander of the 8th Army, yes. Many of the generals were friends of our parents because many of these senior officers lived in those houses on the bluff. Captain Bev Coleman.
He was counsel to the war crimes trial in Tokyo.
In Tokyo of Tohidika Tocho and I see.
Well, he came to visit frequently.
And by that time, incidentally, a lot of kids from American military families had arrived.
That's right.
Remember my first girlfriend, Gail Smith?
Right.
Remember her?
Evelyn Melberg, Colonel Melberg's daughter. Jean Shanzi?
Yes.
His father was Colonel Shanzi.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We had moved back to Yokohama in 1945, and we moved to 46 Yamate-cho. And I got the bedroom in the corner that had a hole in the ceiling.
As a bomb had thrown.
And that had a hole in the floor that went down to the living room. So our first Christmas after the war had ended, we sat around on orange crates.
We had a lovely Christmas tree. We had real candles, some little Christmas balls that they had schlepped around from place to place.
And my parents kept the spirit going. No presents, because there was nothing to buy. But we had the Christmas carols, we had the tree, we had the candles, and the snow was trickling through that hole.
Well, there was one other thing that actually happened. Dad found out that two of his siblings had been killed in
That's
the war.
Right.
We found that out in December or so.
His youngest brother had been killed in an air raid attack in Frankfurt, Germany. As he was coming out of his office to go to the bunker, he'd forgotten something. He ran back to the office, and as he came around the corner of this hall, just then a bomb struck, and he was instantly killed. His youngest sister was fleeing from the Russians in a German bus going from the east to the west, and the bus driver failed to notice that the German authorities had told the bus to stop. They started firing on the bus, thinking that there were enemies, and she was one of two people that was standing in the bus and was killed. So his two youngest siblings died.
We didn't know that until
the
end of the war.
When the war was over, he wanted to come back to America immediately. But we'd had reentry permits, my father, mother, and myself, which were only lasted for 6 months. And, of course, they had expired.
Yeah, when the war ended, there was no way of going, quote, home, unquote.
General Douglas MacArthur enters the first meeting of the Allied Council for Japan, composed of delegates from the United States, Britain, China, and Russia, who will advise the Supreme Commander on occupation policy.
MacArthur directed the Japanese government to deport the German element there as undesirable aliens.
But Father had a very good relationship with the American occupation authorities, and through them, they tried to have these orders rescinded without success.
The Americans said that all Germans had to go back to the country of origin, Germany, and provided troop transports.
I remember distinctly this bus arriving. It was a
right.
school bus.
Yeah,
we trudged into the school bus, the five of us, with one suitcase each, and waved goodbye to our house and everything in it, and were driven to Uraga, which is a port of embarkation. There are all these huts. And we were taken into one of these huts, and we were deloused.
We were sprayed with DDT.
DDT, like a bunch of animals. You know, it was traumatic. At the same time, it was a new adventure.
Right, exactly.
In its harbors lie the disabled remnants of a once powerful fleet.
Now, the Japanese government had no shipping. Everything was destroyed. So the American authorities said, okay, we will furnish you with a couple of vessels to take these people home. And that's how we traveled back on an American ship.
The SS Marine Jumper.
And so off we tootled. The first stop was Shanghai. All these junks coming by, trying to sell us antiques. And they sort of pushed it up all the way on. They had these long, long bamboo sticks, if you remember, trying to sell us their wares. The one thing I remember was somebody died on the ship. They took this person, and there was a service, and they had wrapped the body up in burlap or in a white sheet. And then after the service was just about to conclude, they commended this poor soul to the watery grave and lifted the plank, and the body slipped into the water. That was, for a young kid, was unnerving, because you didn't want to disappear from the world in that way. And then in the Suez Canal, there was the French troop transport ship called the Louis Pasteur, which was sailing to the Pacific as we were coming out of the Pacific going to the Suez Canal. It was full of troops. Of course, later on we found out they were heading to reoccupy Indochina from the Japanese. And then, of course, that terrible storm in the Bay of Biscayne.
It was so rough that at one minute our ship was way up here and the water was down here, and the next minute the water was up here and the ship was down here, and it came tumbling. It was really a dangerous, dangerous trip that we wound. There was also a very nice Captain Gross. And I mean, I was at that point a teenager. He used to say, do you want to go walk around the ship? And he was always very friendly. Captain Gross, do you remember
from
Captain
Brooklyn.
Gross? From Brooklyn.
As we slowly steamed up into Bremerhaven, I remember there were these great chunks of ice in the Weser River. We docked, and on the dock, waiting for us, were some trains.
Yeah, they had U.S. Army written on them.
And they were not first-class trains. They were third-class trains.
Coaches, yes.
Wooden benches.
Yeah. Well, it was a long train ride from Bremerhaven through Bremen, down the Ruhr area, down past Frankfurt to the south. And you stopped in these stations, and these towns were all destroyed. Nothing but steel girders. And yeah, it was a wasteland.
I remember it was a very depressing sight.
And the other thing that I remember so well were the number of people who were begging, people who without any legs or without any arms. It was a horror scene.
It was a scene of real devastation.
The parents who knew Germany much better than we did were, of course, devastated seeing what had happened. We were told we were now going to a Stalag 17-like camp for the denazification process. So my brother Alexander, my mother and I were sent to one camp, and my father and my brother were sent to the other camp.
It was a prison camp, which simply changed ownership. It was from first German, then it was American. We ran across a doctor from Hamburg, and he said to my dad one day, he said, by the way, would you like to meet the Crown Prince of Germany? My dad said, yeah, let's go and visit him. He was in the camp hospital. So this doctor trotted me and my dad to the camp hospital, and there was Prince August Wilhelm, the son of the last Kaiser, and then theoretically the Crown Prince of Germany. So we spent about half an hour chatting with this guy.
My mother and Alexander and I were released a day or two earlier than you. And we stopped by the Hotel Zeppelin in Stuttgart. And lo and behold, who was there? And I'm going to get emotional, Captain Gross. He felt so badly that we were released without any money that he gave each of us 100 German marks. What was particularly poignant was here was a Captain Gross who was of Jewish origin, and that he could be kind to us of German origin was very big of him. And he just was quite wonderful. I remember, though, people sitting on the streets, and you could hear this hammering noise. And what it was they had bricks, and they were hammering the cement off the bricks. And then they would take the clean ones and throw them on a pile, and they'd take the dirty ones, hammer all the cement off, and throw them on the clean piles as they were getting ready to rebuild Germany. And our father had gone through all the denazification papers, was cleared, and off we went to be reunited. We got to Ludwigsburg to pick up our luggage and found that it had been stolen. So basically what we had left was what was on our backs and maybe a change or two of clothes.
Without any clothes, without a job, without a school, without any prospects, and without any food. It's pretty dismal when you think about it.
hard to imagine.
Well, it was certainly a very new experience for us. The country had no government. The government was in Berlin in the form of an Allied Control Council, and each zone was governed by a governor general, basically.
The American, the yes. British, the Russian, and the French.
To Marshal Zhukov's headquarters in the fallen capital of Germany come Supreme Allied Commander Eisenhower and Field Marshal Montgomery. With Nazi Germany dead, the military representatives of four United Nations meet to form an occupational administration. For the Russians, Zhukov signs the document which will establish a stern but just government in Germany. Montgomery signs for Britain. General Eisenhower signs for the United States. General de Lattre de Tassigny represents France.
And you couldn't travel through each of these zones without having an internal passport, and there were passport checks at the border. It was like leaving from one country to another.
Our father was hell-bent on getting us back to America. That's all he cared about. But he felt, well, as long as we had to go, we might as well see the family and then go back to America as soon as possible. My father's side of the family had fled from the Russians in January and February of 1945. They had fled to Bavaria, where one sister had a house.
They went through greater hell than we did.
Yes, absolutely true. Because they fled on foot with horse carts and so on.
And then I remember coming to the house where there were many more people living in that house than normal because they had all fled and had been taken up by their relatives. Grandfather Erklens was there.
That was 10 years after we last saw them, 37 to 47.
It's nice that we're back with family, because when we were in America, we had no family. We had friends. And suddenly we had a lot of cousins, a lot of aunts, a lot of uncles. Looking at it from a family point of view, it was very nice to know that you were part of a larger family unit.
With the grandparents, Erklens, mm-hmm. That's the first time we had ever heard about concentration camps.
Men, women, and children were slain, piled together in common graves. 30,000 are buried here. Throughout Germany, the scene of death repeats itself in concentration camps along the path of the Allied advance.
It was too horrendous.
And the other thing was, of course, all the men had been in the war. Onkel Gotthard von Wallenberg and Pitt Decker, and both actually had been in Stalingrad. It was interesting to find out what they had done during the war. We couldn't stay in Bavaria because there was no room. And so the one place where there might have been some room was with our grandfather on my mother's side. Our grandfather, Schlubach, who had been, they'd owned coffee plantations in Guatemala, and they had been involved in the import-export trade in Hamburg, that was all gone. And so they lived in the country and basically lived from hand to mouth and grew their own strawberries, their own cabbage, their own potatoes, bartered things with the local farmers to get some meat. So we found refuge in their country house. It was to establish a base from which father could then operate to try and get us back to the States. He then undertook to get his life in order. He then went back to Frankfurt with you.
Yes. His dad got a job with the Coca-Cola company.
The Coca-Cola company.
And so I went and got a job too.
And that entitled him to a PX card, which was, of course, our savings.
You could go to the PX and buy all kinds of stuff which you could barter on the black market. Like a carton of cigarettes cost $1, 10 cents a pack. You know. And that was worth gold on the street.
My father rented a one-room flat for he and Enno. And there was a
funny landlady.
Yeah. She used to say to my father, Mr. Erklens, in German, wenn ich schieb, wird geschoben, which translated means, he who doesn't push will be pushed.
Aside from Enno and Dad coming up to visit us in Ventoff, Mother Hillie and I, we occasionally went from Ventoff to visit you in Frankfurt. When we returned from Frankfurt, Hillie, Mother and I would get on the train, we'd go back up to Hamburg. At Celle, which was the border town between the American zone and the British zone, everybody had to get off the train with their suitcases, and we had to open the suitcases to the British soldiers who were looking for contraband. And of course, we had one suitcase full of these goodies that you had gotten at the PX.
Yeah, right.
And of course, the eyes of the British, who themselves were not getting a lot of food.
Oh, that's right, yeah.
They were under starvation diets, practically. When they saw this contraband, they were looking forward to, you know, confiscating it and taking it back to the barracks. And of course, they say, okay, raus. And they said, and then I was 11, 12 years old, I would step up and said, not so fast, guys. And I take out my American passport and said, I'm an American. That belongs to me. And they respected that.
You were really responsible for all of us staying alive, including the grandparents, because you were providing, through the cigarettes and coffee, the necessary barter to get eggs and milk. By now, we were getting rations. They were papers about this big, and you would cut off 100 grams of meat and maybe 10 grams of bread.
Once the new currency came in, that all changed.
Bales of Germany's old Reichsmarks turned in for the new Deutsch or D-Marks, recently issued by the Western Allies in Germany's currency reform.
But I do remember lining up with Dad at a place in Frankfurt that June day, going to this desk. After a while, you got to the desk and you were handed these 40 new Deutsche Marks. And everybody felt rich.
Overnight, the next day, suddenly, all these goods that had not been in the stores previously appeared.
The first thing that our parents did was to see to it that at least Alexander and I would be able to continue school. So Alexander and I were sent to a boarding school in the south of Germany in Baden called the Schule Schloss Salem. And he was actually sent to Kirchberg, which is an offshoot.
A, I was by myself. B, there was no food, or the food that was inedible. And C, I was an American kid who didn't speak very much German. So it was not a very, very pleasant time for me. And I cried and cried. I was very unhappy there. But when I left 2.5 years later, I was in tears, not because I was unhappy, but it was very sad to be leaving.
I said, I am going to hate this school. And my parents said, well, give it 2 weeks, and if you don't like it in 2 weeks, we'll pick you up. Very simple. Well, within about a week or 10 days, I just loved the whole atmosphere. It was wonderful. We put on plays and operas. I sang Cherubino in The Marriage of Figaro, and I was a priestess in The Magic Flute. It was just so rich in culture. It was also nice because there were young men there. And of course, that was the age when one was saying, oh, you know, discovered boys. So it was the perfect timing.
But I mean, the whole thing, idea was you had to get a good education. And that's one of the things that our parents inculcated in us, the importance of getting good education, expanding your mind. I think Salem gave that to us in spades.
And they brought it home to us by reminding us that we had lost everything in the war and that anybody can take anything away from you, but what you have in your head, no one can take away from you. They stressed the importance of filling that brain with knowledge and learning.
Dad used to go to the American consulate on a regular basis to see how are my reentry papers coming. And then I guess one fine day in 1950, the papers arrived.
Mm-hmm. I was thrilled to pieces to be going back. Of course, our dad was so delighted that that was catching as well. My mother was always a little hesitant because she hated to leave all her family and her relatives, her cousins, and she had so many of them.
We made one final trip through Germany before we left, down to Munich,
right.
And we saw this performance of yours, Figaro's
Upside. At the America House.
Yeah. And then we went to Salem, visited that. And then we went back, and we left Hamburg on an American boat, the American Merchant, right. U.S. lines.
Then, obviously, what is, again, indelibly imprinted in my mind is, as we entered New York Harbor, seeing the Statue of Liberty. It was a clear day. It was Manhattan. It was a wonderful sight.
Seeing the Statue of Liberty was quite undoing. It was a very emotional moment. Because there we finally were back, and there were these tall, wonderful skyscrapers. Somehow or another, it just was overwhelmingly impressive. I just remember nothing but yellow cabs among all the gray buildings. And of course, we got up, and the first thing we did was we got a yellow cab.
And Father and Enno took us to our new abode, which was the Hotel Wales on Madison Avenue and 94th Street, which was our first home. You started school right then and there, right, because it was September, and then once you had graduated and got on to Columbia, then I was allowed to go to collegiate and spend 4 years there on scholarship. Mm-hmm. And you, Hillie?
Well, I was then 17. I had to get working papers. I went to work to Time, Inc., and I started on the 23rd floor, which was Time Life International, and started delivering the mail and as an office girl. Soon after that, I was promoted. When I got to Fortune, I became a receptionist. Then one day, as you all know, your soon-to-be brother-in-law, Arthur, walked in, and
the rest is history.
The rest is history.
There was Dad, who before the war had been a successful banker, lived at 1192 Park Avenue, had a house in Southampton, kids went to private school, and suddenly there he is with a wife, three children, not a dime in the bank to speak of. And Dad was basically knocking on the doors of banks looking for a job. And literally one day, there was just enough money left to buy a Sunday New York Times. And Dad had run out of money. And the question was, you know, he didn't have a job, where to get it, and he was not about to go on welfare. So Mother's family from Hamburg, the Schlubachs, had always been very friendly with the Warburg family, who were prominent bankers in Hamburg. And Mother and Father knew Freddie Warburg, who was a partner of Kuhn Loeb. So Mother went down to see Freddie at their offices on William Street and told Freddie what the problem was and asked in a very embarrassed way, could she borrow some money to tide us over until Dad got a job? And so Freddie Warburg wrote out a check for $10,000. That was a huge amount of money in those days. And after a number of years, he was able to finally save $10,000 and went down with Mother to Freddie Warburg with a check and said, Freddie, I just want you to know how much we appreciate helping us in such difficult times. Mm-hmm. And gave him the check, and Freddie said, Enno Hildegard, he said, that is not necessary, and tore up the check in front of them, yes.
And I was making $25 a week. And I tried to contribute what I could, but obviously it wasn't enough.
Of course, Mother was, although she was on the surface a very soft and kind, loving mother, she underneath was a very, very tough woman. And she went through all these trials and tribulations in the Second World War. Not once do I remember did she break down.
Or complain.
Or complain. She was fabulous.
Took everything in stride.
Yeah, she took everything. And she had been brought up in a very privileged background.
When she was married, her trousseau was all made to order by designers. I mean, she really had been very privileged. And her father spoiled her rotten. $25 a week was really rather meager pay. And so when my friend said, oh, why don't you go modeling, because there you get $50 an hour, I thought to myself, that's a pretty good deal. So I found an agency that would represent me. And the first thing they did, they said, oh, go over to the Waldorf Astoria and try out for Miss Rheingold. It carries with it a $50,000 prize, and you get to reign the entire year, and you are a representative of the Liebman Breweries. So I decided to go to the Waldorf, and there was Irene Dunn and Paul Hesse, the photographer. So we presented our pictures, and then you either got a blue slip or a pink slip. And if you got the blue slip, you remained. If you got the pink slip, you didn't bother to come back. So I kept getting the blue slip, which was very nice, and it went from 3,000 to 1,500, then down to 750. I was one of the last six chosen. And with that, we went on a six-week campaign in New York and upstate New York, opening fairs and going in parades and having our own cars and waving to the crowds. For me, who'd been in these different countries, all of a sudden I saw America for free and was getting paid for it. After counting the votes, it was announced the end of November, beginning of December, that I had won the election. And I had to prepare very quickly to become Queen of Winter and Lake Placid with Johnny Padres, who was then King of Winter and I was Queen of Winter. He and I reigned over the winter sports at the Lake Placid Club in Lake Placid. And that's the way I started my year as Miss Rheingold of 1956.
So for the next 12 months, we had the pleasure, wherever we went, to see our sister changing her wardrobe. It was wonderful because wherever we went, there were these huge billboards with Sister Hillie, if you remember.
Yeah, well, I remember because I used to travel from Boston to Grand Central on the New Haven Railroad when I would come home for weekends from Harvard. And her poster would always be at the end of the car.
So you couldn't escape
miss,
her.
Couldn't miss, yes.
And welcome again to Germany.
And that, as you know, is Hillie Merritt, Miss Rheingold of 1956. And for the next few minutes, we're going to take you on a visit to the castle of Neuschwanstein. Translated roughly, it means New Swan Cliff, or stone, or rock. And from a distance, it looks like a fairy castle on the mountainside. You can't drive right up to the gates, so Hillie and I had to do the last part of our journey on foot. We walked up hundreds of steps, some straight like these, others curving round and round inside the towers.
During the filming of the Rheingold commercial in Germany, I couldn't help thinking what a long road back it had been for all of us since our 10-year odyssey had come to an end 6 years earlier.
I visited our mother in Ventov years ago, and I said, I want to sit down and I want to interview you. And so I started asking her a lot of questions, and we sat one afternoon. It was about 3 or 4 hours that we sat, and I kept asking her questions, and she kept answering, and I kept asking. And at the end of it was the most interesting experience. I was so down, and she was so elated. And I tried to figure out what it was, why I was so down, and she was so elated. And I realized it was because all through this period of time that she talked about, she was basically actively in the act of surviving and having to take care of the three of us. And so when she looked back, she was really rather pleased when she really sort of focused on what she'd been through, how amazing, and was still so up and full of life and full of beans. She was dancing at 70. She was just having a ball.
The reason of the flowers was because Opie did send them to me for our 56th wedding anniversary.
That because of the war, the ambitious goals he had set for himself were not realized, which of course caused him a great deal of sadness and unhappiness, but he never once really let it show. It was only in his 70s, you had a little heart to heart with him. He'd feel very badly that he couldn't have given us a better life. Although I always told him, I said, listen, you gave us the best life possible. And we would not be the people we are if they hadn't done such a great job with us.
Right.
We were very lucky. I mean, we got to the edge, and then we were, somehow or another, everything turned out all right. My father used to say, a blessing in disguise. See, they were so positive, I think, but that's why, no matter how hard things were, there was always some redeeming feature. Oh, it'll toughen you up.
Having to leave Japan, you know, being deported by the Japanese government. Well, that was a bad thing, but on the other hand, there was a positive thing because we got out of Japan that way.
Exactly.
On our way to where we wanted to go. Or being made to leave Yokohama by the Japanese government, you know, yeah, during the middle of the war. That was not great, a great thing to have to go to a summer resort and stay there the winter. On the other hand, it saved us from being in the bombs. The glass was half full rather than half empty.
And there was always a perseverance on our father's point, and then translated to us, that you just continued on no matter what.
And continue on they did, guiding us growing up, seeing us married and having children, taking delight in their grandchildren, and encouraging them as they had encouraged us. In the summer of 1986, 60 years after our father had first come to America, our parents moved back to Germany, retiring to the same hunting lodge where we had spent a few years after returning from Japan. The following winter, they came back to America to visit us, and just before their scheduled return home, our father passed away peacefully at the age of 84 in New York, the city that had been his life's blood. Our mother continued traveling between the two continents and was able to enjoy life with her friends, her children and grandchildren for 9 more years. She passed away peacefully in Connecticut at the age of 87, surrounded by her devoted family.
Nothing but blue birds.
They don't.
All day.